but we are in this series called I Refuse. I believe that it's more than a message for me. I believe it's more than a sermon series for me. I believe it's a mantra for my life that God's placed on me. One of those things that, you know, when you were brought up, or you, as you grew up, you were a fighter. That fight never really goes away. You can learn to mask being a fighter. You can be a little bit silent and not pick fights, but a fighting spirit's always there. And I'm realizing more, as the Bible says, that the kingdom of heaven has suffered violence, and it will be the violent that take it by force. Yet, we've become such a lackadaisical society where we're non-confronting. We hate confrontation, right? And so we sit back and allow things to happen, yet we then blame God for those things happening. I don't know. Just some thoughts that are going through my mind, if I'm making any sense. We're so quick to blame God when things don't go our way, although God gave us some promises. He said, speak to the mountain, and it will be removed from your life. He didn't say, beg God to move mountains. He said, you speak to the mountain. God said to you that he has given you the ability to create wealth. That's a scripture in the Bible. He has given you the ability to create wealth. Yet, Christians will sit home and beg God to bring finances into their house. When he said, put your hand to the plow. It's funny, in my life, I've heard stories my whole life of how pastors went to their mailbox and there were $10,000 checks in their mailbox. I never got one of those. I'd get to a tight spot in my life and I'd be like, God, I really need some money right now. The septic system broke on my house. I need a septic system. Called the guy up, hey, how much is it gonna be for a septic system? $10,000. Guess how much money I had? $1. I didn't have the money to put a septic system. But I got a phone call. Hey, we need a telephone system installed at XYZ. The estimate from Frontier was $22,000. How much will you do it for? $11,000. $10,000 for my septic and $1,000 for my tithe. Hey, Shando. I did the job in 2 days. Two days. I did the whole job in two days because I'm not union. I can get in there and do it. You know what I'm saying? No restrictions on me. And I sometimes sit back and I'm like, yo, God, what's up? What's good with that, man? These people getting free checks. And every time I ask you for money, you send me a job. He said, because you can. Because you can. I've given you the ability to create wealth. So sometimes I think we just need to look for the opportunity. You know, we pray, ask God for opportunity. It's like the guy who was stranded in the middle of the ocean. Right, his boat sank and he's floating out there and he says, God, save me. And a ship comes by and the ship says, hey, do you need help? And he says, no, I'm waiting for God. And a little bit later, a helicopter flies by and a rescuer's lowered down. Hey, you need some help? He says, no, I'm waiting for God. And then later on, a jet skier goes by, stops, says, hey, you need some help? He says, no, I'm waiting for God. The guy dies, he drowns. Can't tread water for so long. Goes to heaven, stands before God. He says, God, what's good? I was floating out there for days. I begged you to save me. He said, I sent you a boat. I sent you a helicopter and a jet ski. How many times God does the same things in our lives? No, I don't want a job. I want a $100 handshake. I want a check to show up in my mailbox, okay? God has given us the ability, the power, personal responsibility in what we're to do in life today. And one of those personal responsibilities is to share our faith, is to share our faith with those around us. We've been talking about this for a few weeks now. In fact, I think what I'm gonna do this Sunday is go back and do one of the messages I did during the summer about the four pillars of the church and what Family Church is doing here today. I think we had a lot of people on vacation who kind of missed some of those things, but it'll put us back in line with where we're headed for this year. But we started talking in the book of John, John chapter 1, where it said that God sent a man named John to testify of the light. He's talking about Jesus, to testify of Jesus. It says he was not the light. He was not the answer. He was just a person who's to point to the answer. And it says that everyone would come to Christ or come to salvation by John's testimony. And in week one, we were talking about the importance of your testimony. So now tonight, I want to ask this question. And if you were here Sunday, you kind of know it's a little bit of a setup. But how many of you in here today would consider yourself a creative person? You would consider yourself a creative person. You know, you paint, you make stuff, you build stuff. About five of you. Okay, there we go, a little bit more, eight. All right, let me ask you this question. How many of you in here would consider yourselves problem solvers? You like to solve problems. See, a lot more people, right? Now watch this statement. Creativity is the search for solutions. Creativity is the search for solutions. Everything created in the world today was created to solve a problem. Okay? How many of you were alive when we had telephones that hung on the wall with a cord connected to it? All right? If you're under 30, you have no idea what this is. Right? And you had to literally stand by the phone and talk on it. So then they got creative. They got creative. Now they got these like 25-foot slinky looking cords. Remember these? And then you could have it all through the house and be sitting on the couch all the way back to the phone. Because it was a problem having to stand in the kitchen because now everybody can hear your conversation. Oh, we need to fix this. We need to create cordless phones. And they came out with those big, huge cordless phone that you could then have in your house. Then we went crazy. We tried to make phones as small as possible. Tiny little things, tiny little flip phones, Nokia phones. Couldn't even barely hold it in your hand. Now we're trying to make phones as big as possible again. Let's talk on iPads now. But what were we doing? We were continually solving problems. So creativity is the catalyst, right? Problems are the catalyst for creativity. Problems are the catalyst for creativity. When an inventor invents something, his or her creativity is based on an existing problem. His or her creativity is based on an existing problem. I told Sunday service, I don't know if I told every service, but when I was in school, we had something called Invent America. Anybody did Invent America? I'm all alone. Invent America. It was a thing in science class where you had to come up with an invention. And so I took one of my dad's push brooms and I connected a hose to it. And I broke out the hose into multiple splitters with sprayer nozzles. And I made the broom that you could, the power broom, I think I called it, something like that. And I mean, I put a lot of time and energy and effort into this thing. And they told me, nope, it's no good. It'll never make it. I just saw on QVC last week a broom that you can connect to the hose. And it's got sprayer jets on it. I invented that. In Invent America in eighth grade. Someone else just made millions of dollars on what I, you know, because my dad would make me go outside and sweep the driveway. But you know, you couldn't get all the dirt out of the blacktop on the driveway. So I created something that would solve a problem because problems are the catalyst for creativity. This sound system today, none of you know this, I'm going to tell you right now what happened. We had the 5-minute countdown going, and all of a sudden, I heard, boom, sound system went out. Sound system went out. Literally, the bottom two little speakers right there were the only things that were playing any sound. Sweat just comes down my face, because when a sound system like this goes, it's not like a $5 fix, all right? And the components are so expensive that you don't keep backups, right? It would be great that you could, but you don't keep a $10,000 backup just to sit there that you may never use. So sweat, I'm like, oh my God, we're done. We're gonna like, I'm gonna have to scream. I'm gonna have to use a bullhorn for church tonight. And went in the back, and one of the power supplies blew. So I just had to, you know, swap that out, which is easy enough to do. So by 2 minutes in the countdown, we were back up and running, right? But sound systems were created so that people didn't have to yell. Public address systems. Vehicles solve a transportation problem. Mechanics solve vehicle problems. Dentists solve tooth problems. Lawyers solve legal problems. And you get where I'm going with that, okay? And that's why we are alive today. We are all alive today to solve a problem. To solve a problem. You see, God created Adam to solve a problem. Now, I'm going to give you a little bit of a deeper teaching tonight than maybe you've heard before, and this might go against something that you've been taught, but I want you to have a clear mind in what I'm about to say about God. God did not create man. God did not create man because he was lonely. Okay? Maybe you were taught that. You know, God was lonely in heaven up there. He got sick of the Son and the Holy Ghost, so he had to, you know, make something new, so he made man. That's not why he made man, okay? That's not why he made man. God did not make man so that there would be somebody to worship him, right? Maybe you've been taught that before too. Well, you know, Lucifer, he was the archangel in charge of music, in charge of worship. And the Bible doesn't say that, by the way. He wasn't like a worship pastor with skinny jeans on and a jean jacket, okay? That wasn't Lucifer. The Bible simply just says that he was a cherubim. And that he was so beautiful and so amazing that as he walked, music just emanated from him. So now, we could probably try to connect the dots, but he wasn't the worship leader. Nor was now God lacking worship because Lucifer was gone. The Bible says that if we were to go to heaven right now, all the angels are bowing and worshiping, singing, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come." God is not devoid of anything. God is not lacking anything. There's no deficiency in God where he would have to create something to get something back. You know, that's like me saying, I had kids so that someone would worship me. How narcissistic. I had kids to worship me. I have a 15-year-old. And any given day, if she just simply likes me, I'm doing good. Right? Get my 15-year-old to like me, I'm doing good, let alone worship me. God didn't create you to worship him. If he created humanity to worship him, it's a failed mission. It's a failed mission. It was failed at best in here by about 30%. Because only about 30% of us in here worshiped really tonight. We watched somebody else worship. I'm just making you think tonight, all right? I'm just throwing it out there. If that's what all this is about, worshiping God, we kind of missed the point. And he had a really flawed design. Do you know why God created man? First and foremost, because he could. Because he could. Because he's a creator. He's an inventor. It's what he does. It's who he is. Secondly, he wanted a creation that he could infuse his love into, something that was his very own, that he could have a connection with, that he could be as emotionally attached to them as they could be to him. Now, isn't that more like why we had kids? Take that little baby. Look at their chubby little face. And you know that thing is ugly as heck. But it's the most beautiful thing you've ever seen in your life. Till their head all gets normalized, right? You sit there all night, the first night, keep putting your finger in their nose to make sure they're breathing. Because everything about them is China doll perfect. The nose is just perfect, and the eyes are just perfect. And inside yourself, there's a pride that comes about. I made that. I did that. And in that moment, where that child could give nothing back to you, nothing, that child doesn't even love you yet. Incapable of giving anything back to you. In that moment, the first seconds of life, you would give your life for that child. And you don't even know them. You don't know what their voice is ever going to sound like. You don't know if they're ever going to be good at sports or not good at sports, whether they're going to be straight-A student or not a straight-A student. But in a split second, you are absolutely drop-dead in love with them, and you would do anything for them. That's why God created you. That's why your Heavenly Father created you. And he's like, I'm going to create the best world that they could possibly be in. And I'm going to design it with fruits and berries and trees for shade. And think about this. Unfortunately, in our lives, we've been told a lie about our God. When there's an earthquake or a tornado, it's an act of God. When turmoils and things happen, well, God must be trying to teach you something. And the view that's been painted about our God is that he's at best abusive. He's at best a child abuser. And who would want to serve that God anyway? See, I refuse stands for more than simply just sharing our faith, is I refuse to believe a lie about God. I refuse to stand back and watch lies be told about him. A few years ago, when I knew I was going to be going into a new direction of preaching, God said to me that I want you to introduce me to your friends like you would your wife. You want everybody to love your wife. Let's say you're dating, you want everybody to love your girlfriend, your boyfriend. You tell everything that's amazing and great about them, because that's what we do. Show the love connection to my people and it'll change their lives. See, this is all of our mission. This is what we're all supposed to do. God created us to fill that in him, that he would have something to pour into. But then man had a problem. God created man. Man was perfect, but perfect man had a problem. And in Genesis 2:18, it says this: the Lord God said, it is not good for man to be alone. Men say hallelujah. Unless you're happy being alone, I don't know. He said this: I will make a helper suitable for him. It's not good that man be alone. Man's got a problem. He needs somebody. He needs somebody. He needs somebody to talk to. He needs somebody to watch sports with, especially when he's a Jets fan. He needs somebody to wipe his tears when the Jets hit the field. So Eve was the solution to Adam's problem. And I want to throw that out there today, that you are a solution in the world today. This is not some pep talk motivational message. This is talking to your spirit, spirit to spirit, that if you get this concept in your everyday life, it will radically transform the way you hold your shoulders in your head. That you are a solution in the world today. You are the solution to your relationships. You are a solution to your job. Today I want to talk to you about this. I refuse to be the problem because I'm created to be a solution. Now, notice I didn't say that you won't have problems. We're all going to have problems. We're all going to have problematic moments in our life. But that doesn't mean that we have to have problem-filled days, okay? Because we can bring solutions. You may have depressed moments, But that doesn't mean that you have to have a depressed-filled day, an anxiety-filled day. You are in control of that. You have the power to take every thought and every imagination captive and make it come in subjection to the Word of God. But many times we choose to waller in depression and waller in anxiety and waller in our emotions and stay in bed and have the lights off. When we make that decision, we allow that to happen. Does that say that the action that triggered that feeling wasn't real? No, I'm sure it was very real. But you get to decide what you do with that, right? You decide whether it takes you out and takes you down, or you use it as a stepping stone. Okay? I want you to see something today. Every day when you wake up, you are looking into an entire world full of solutions. Tonight, you're looking at a room with over 200 solutions. Solutions to the world today. You are a solution to somebody. But so many times, we only ever view life as being full of the problems. There's so many problems today. Problems today. And you know it. You know when you're sitting next to somebody who's negative. The moment they open their mouth, they start to talk, you feel their negative energy. And negative energy can suck the passion out of a room faster than anything else. They're like leeches, man. And like, I can't get out of the room fast enough when I'm surrounded by negative people. I'm literally like, I'm about to say something stupid to you. I gotta get out of here. I can't stand it, man, because it literally will take everything of your dreaming and your passion and your motivation right out of you. So I'm sure what this person went through was rough, but you don't have to remain sowing seeds of negativity to other people. I've been studying this idea of Jeremiah. I believe God spoke to me when I was reading in Jeremiah. And watch this. He says in Jeremiah 1:5, "Before I formed you, in the womb I chose you. Before I formed you in the womb, I chose." Somebody's pregnant, or you're connected to somebody who's pregnant. They're going through some prenatal issues. Claim a verse that God's forming my child in my womb. That God is forming my child in my womb. If you're watching online and that's for you, God is forming that child in your womb. You quote that. You own this. Again, you take this verse, you take charge of it and apply it. And hey, it might be you right here. I don't know what I'm saying. Before I formed you in the womb, I chose you. Now, this means something to me because I haven't always been a perfect person. Still ain't, right? Today, I might have been quite perfect. I might have had perfect moments. But God's saying this, before you ever did anything dumb, before you ever made a mistake, before you ever failed at anything, before you ever told a lie, I chose you. Yeah, but you know, then I did all that stuff and I became an alcoholic and I became a drug addict, I became a heroin addict, and I disqualified myself. No. You don't know God. God's not sitting on the sidewalk watching the parade of your life go by. From his vantage point, he sees your life from beginning to end. He knows. Now listen, I personally don't believe that God has predestined every decision that you're making, but I believe that he knows what you're already going to do. But he still allows you to make those choices. That's your life. He knows it, okay? He says, listen, okay, I know when they're going to do this. I know the first time that they're going to smoke that crack pipe. I know the first time they're going to snort a line of coke, the first beer they're ever going to have that's going to take them into a whirlwind of alcoholism, and I still choose them. And I still choose them. I take their humanity into account. I factor all of their mistakes into the equation, and at the end of the day, it still equals worthy. It still equals worthy. I still want to use them for my kingdom and my glory and my honor. This is what he's saying right here. Listen, look through new eyes. Before I formed you in the womb, I chose you. Before you ever made a mistake, I chose you. I approved you. I appointed you. Watch. He goes, before you were born, I set you apart. You've been mine the whole time. You know why that car accident didn't kill you? Because I set you apart. You know why that drug addiction didn't kill you? I set you apart. Come on, somebody. Maybe you can look. I remember one time we were on a motorcycle trip with Kenny. Kenny went around a turn. He had these low running boards on his bike. He goes around a turn. He was going fast. He couldn't make the turn. His pegs were scraping the thing. His bike went across two lanes of road, off the road, on the other side of the guardrail, and there was about 2 feet of earth before a cliff. And he ain't that good of a rider. Somehow his bike hung in that 2 feet of curb and that 2 feet of earth next to that cliff to hold him on. Because I set you apart. Because I set you apart. And he said this, I appointed you as a voice to the earth today. He says it like this, I appointed you as a prophet to the nations. But somebody has to be a voice in our circles of influences. Somebody has to refuse to be silent. Somebody has to say, no, this is what's right. This is what God's saying to us today. You were created for a specific purpose, a very special purpose, and that's to solve a problem in the earth today. The richest people in the world, the biggest businesses in the world, they found what their problem is to solve, and they stay in that lane. They stay in that lane. I asked some people on staff, I'm reading this book, and I put this question up on the whiteboard in my office. What were you born to do? Now, you take about a week and chew on that question. Not what do you like to do? Not what do you enjoy doing? What could you do and have a fun time? What seems cool to do? What were you born to do? What were you organically crafted to do? What can you do the best in the whole world? You answer that question. You answer that question. It will radically transform your life. You answer that question, and it will demand action in you. You answer that question, and it will wake you up every morning and get you out of bed and get you dressed. Just the answer to that question. Do you know why people struggle to get out of bed? Because they don't know the answer to that question. Nobody was created. Nobody was born to do a job they hate. Nobody. Nobody. Be the solution. Refuse to be the problem. If we can get past our clogged and dirty filters, if we can stop doing what Jeremiah did, Jeremiah was full of excuses. After God said this to him and God called him, Jeremiah responds back to God in Jeremiah 1:7. He says, but God, I'm too young. I don't know what to say. Who's going to listen to me? And God says back to him, but the Lord said to me, stop with the excuses. Stop with trying to disqualify yourself. Do you know how hard it is sometimes to be a preacher on stage and see people that I went to school with walk in the door? Sometimes I'm like, I hope they don't remember me. I hope they don't know my name. They don't remember my name. And that since I'm bald, it throws them off. You know when you see people who know your past. Because I was two different people. I was church Mike and I was school Mike. They were two different people. Somebody say, God, like, I'm going to reach people who no, I lived a really bad life. That did some bad stuff in school. God said to Jeremiah, stop with the excuse. Don't say you're too young. Don't say you're not educated enough. Don't say you've done too many bad things. He said, because I called you. I qualified you. I set you apart. And he says this, and you must go to everyone I send you to and say whatever I command you to say. My mom said like this to me. My mom would come and say, hey, Mike, the church play is coming up. I said, yeah, I don't think I'm going to do the church play today. My mom would say back to me, what about what I just said made you think you had an option? What about what I just said made you think that you had an option in this? Well, okay. She said, I already made your costume. You must go to everyone I send you and say whatever I command you. Do not be afraid of them. In fact, I could almost hear God say this, don't you dare. Don't you dare be afraid of somebody. Don't you dare be. I almost wish God gave me a little bit more fear in me because I got beat up a lot. I got beat up a lot because I wasn't afraid of nobody. I don't see the fact that you're bigger than me is going to make a difference. I didn't see the difference. David didn't see Goliath being bigger than him making any difference. I just didn't know how to fight. My parents wouldn't let me take karate. I can hear God say this, don't you dare be afraid of them. Don't you dare be afraid of the world. Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. If God is for us, who can be against us? What shall man do unto me? The same spirit that raised Christ from the dead lives and abides on the inside of you. You're 10 times better. You're blessing a city. You're blessing a field. You're blessed coming and going. Everything you set your hands to will prosper and be successful. Hey, but do we know this? Do we know this? You are the solution. Don't you dare be afraid of them, for I am Just simply ask that question. Do you believe that God's with you? Or do you believe at some point he's abandoned you? He was with me for a long time, and now I don't feel him, and I'm not seeing the results. I think he's abandoned me. I think God forgot about me. It's very easy to get there. It's very easy when we don't see things happening in our time frame. Saying, you know, at once I believed that he was with me, but I'm not so sure I believe that anymore. I'm not so sure I believe that God's always with me. I think sometimes he chooses when to be with me. He says, I am with you always. I will rescue you. You're the solution. But isn't it funny that we find ourselves constantly talking about problems? Problems. Problems, problems, problems. And problems put you in a negative posture. Talking about problems steal joy from you. Talking about problems pull anger out of you. Here at Family Church, our team knows that if they're going to come put a problem on the table for discussion, they need to come with two solutions. Two solutions. What are two things? And I like options. I like when Adriana is creating a new graphic, I say, all right, well, bring me options. Don't just create one look. I want options. Because if you only bring me one thing and I don't like it, now it's easy to take it personal. But you bring me like four or five options, we're bound to find one that I somewhat like. And I say, all right, let's take this one, and now let's add the flair of this one. And now as a creative, you're not being crushed. If you're a creative, I'm helping somebody right now. If you're a creative in here, and you're finding yourself in an environment where you're constantly giving ideas to management, to your boss, and you feel like they're crushing you and none of your ideas are getting through, then come with multiple options of that idea. Come with multiple options to that idea. Because the idea might be right, but it might just be packaged wrong. It might just be packaged wrong. So like Adriana might bring me a design, but everything about the design I love, but it's the wrong color. So give me a few color options. Are we gonna stick with the gray? Do you wanna go with the blue? And now, for her, she's not being crushed when I say, I don't like one and two, but I like three. Let's go with three. Because at least I like what you created. Now, if you're a creative, don't take everything personal. It's very hard when they say, I don't like this, you hear, I don't like you. You failed. You didn't do a good job. And that's not what's being said, but a creative hears that, they perceive that. So the multiple options brings that win-win. One of the things they're gonna like, and now we can build upon it. All right, I hope that helps somebody. I refuse to be the problem, I will be the solution. Now let me ask you this, are you the solution in your marriage? Or have you allowed yourself to be the problem? Are you the solution at your job, or are you part of the water cooler gossip problem? Like, you are in charge of that. You have control of that. You are the solution, but do you see yourself that way? Can you see yourself that way? Can you take your step back from a moment or a situation or a problem and process it and say, okay, how can I be part of this solution? We're going to get done here in the next few minutes, okay? I want to wrap up with some thoughts about being a solution in the Spirit, all right? Matthew 28:16 says this, then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. We find a truth right here. Many times, to win any battle in your life, you simply just need to show up. Simply show up, okay? They went to where God told them to go. Already a win. They obeyed. They went. They went there. They did it. It is so hard sometimes to get yourself moving towards where God's leading. But if we can just at least get the motion going, if we at least show up, it's half the battle. When they saw Jesus, they worshiped him. But some doubted. And these were his disciples. These were the 11 who were left. And some of them still doubted, ah, that ain't him. I saw him die. Jesus. Then Jesus came to them and said this, all authority. Now let what I'm about to say hit you in your spirit. Don't process it in your brain, because your brain's gonna filter this all wacky. Listen to this with your spirit. Jesus said to them, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Jesus is standing there in front of them saying, I have all power and all authority, but I want to empower you. I don't want to hold it to myself. I want to give it to you. He says, now go. Go make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. You know what he's doing here? He's empowering leadership. He's saying, I could hold all this, but I have a problem. I gotta go back to heaven, and someone's gotta complete my mission. Someone's gotta do what I was sent here to do, and that's spread the gospel of Jesus Christ to all the corners of the earth. He says, so I'm giving you that power. I'm giving you that commission. I'm giving you that authority. All the authority given to me, I'm transferring it to you. Don't you dare be afraid of them. Don't you dare be afraid, because I am with you always and I will rescue. See, it's the same message. It's never changed. From Jeremiah through the Gospels till Jesus leaves, it's the same message. I've given you power. I've given you decision. I've given you choice. Will you go tell those about me? You are the solution to the Great Commission problem. The mission is great, but the number of people saying yes to it are few. Can you believe today that you're called to reach your circle of influence? Can you believe today that through a simple thing like an I Refuse bracelet and somebody seeing it on your wrist, that it would spark a conversation? That you would be able to share your faith with someone that you might have never engaged with before, and either invite them to church or invite them to accept Jesus Christ. Don't you dare be afraid of their face. Don't you dare be afraid, because he is with you always. But I might not know what to say. Do you believe that he's with you? It says that the Holy Spirit, that out of your bellies will come rivers of living water. Like, you begin to say things you didn't even know you knew to say. But God just needs someone to show up. To show up where somebody needs him. And he'll give you the words to say. He'll use you. Amen? Would you turn to the person next to you and ask them, have you ever made a decision for Jesus? If they say yes, shake their hand. If they say no, ask them, would you like to? If they say no, say, see you next week. If they say yes, they'd like to, grab their hand. Pray this prayer with me. Dear God, I come to you just like I am. I believe Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior. I accept you into my life to change me and to make me new. Thank you for accepting me. In Jesus' name, amen. If you prayed that for the first time, or you were with somebody who prayed that, there's a book on the seat back in front of you. It talks about what we believe here at Family Church. There's no commitment to that. We just want you to have the information. If you're on the fence, if you were one of those people today where you were like, this was all good, I really like your jean jacket and all, but I don't know if I'm into the whole Jesus thing, take the book and read it. Just see if something touches your heart and touches your spirit. All the way in the back of the book is the same prayer that we just prayed tonight. All right? If you have questions, reach out. I'm always available. Miss Emmeline's available. Josh is available. Any of our staff members are available to have a conversation with you. Any person at the high top tables in the back can answer any questions about Christianity, about Jesus. If it's your first time here, don't rush out of here. Connect with somebody. We believe that life change happens in the confines of relationships. So we would love to create a relationship with you, make some friends. All right? For those of you who are signed up for the men's fishing trip, woo, deep sea fishing, Saturday, this Saturday, sorry if you didn't sign up, the boat's booked, meet here at 5 a.m., all right, 5 a.m., we're heading out, go deep sea fishing, deep sea tuna, no, just, I wish tuna. And if you just need a hug tonight, if you would like to meet somebody, come up here. Don't rush out. I want to meet you. I want to give you a hug. Amen. Father, we thank you for tonight. We thank your word speaking to our hearts and our minds. We thank you for renewing our minds to your word every time we hear it, inspiring us to live our faith out loud. As we leave here today, Lord, I thank you that we're protected and safe. Everything we set our hands to will prosper and be successful in Jesus' name. Amen. Love you.